So Jaybhai, somebody's asking, what are you doing to stop our people from being converted at the ground level? What is it that you do?
You see, this is a very personal question, saying that, look, you're talking high philosophy, it's wonderful, presenting the deeper vision of Hinduism, but what are you actually doing practically to make sure our youth are not in a way being pressurized to get converted or feel offended? You know, because when they interact with other youngsters in their schools, colleges, place of work, they always feel on the back foot, thinking that, look, their religion is weird and they have to kind of be defensive all the time. How do you protect them from being pressurized to convert? And conversion is an easy option, because then you say, look, our religion is so simple, otherwise you go to hell, so better convert. So there's a serious issue now that we face, and how do we do that? And this young person has asked me very pointed questions, saying, what are you doing at ground level? Means that, what are you actually practically doing? I must turn this question on his head. My friend, I have to ask you, what are you doing? This is what I am doing. You see, what we are doing is this. For the last 25 years, I've been presenting very kind of rational, structured vision of Hinduism in the education system in the United Kingdom. Very successfully, perhaps the most successful individual doing this work in this country for the last 25 years, devoted to just presenting structured, rational vision of Hinduism. I've been successful. Now, what has happened in the last few years is that we've discovered this magic tool called WhatsApp. Now, WhatsApp goes free, provided you are near a Wi-Fi station, you can watch WhatsApp clips free of charge. You don't need to pay for the data. So we have discovered this magic tool that allows us to present the same structured vision of Hinduism to the ordinary person in India who can just get access to the Wi-Fi. Our only limitation is language. I can only speak Gujarati and English, so I can't speak Hindi. So that's my drawback. But still, there are about 1 billion Hindus in India, and 120 million are quite familiar with English. So I am doing my best to at least present this structured vision of Hinduism to our own people. Why am I doing this? Look, unless you give very structured, rational version of your tradition to your youngsters, they are under attack. Because at the moment, only Hinduism they know has come from a very scattered background, very, you know, weird background, in fact, whereby they have picked up bits about Hinduism from some this and that, and it's all very superficial. It is purely narrative-based, colorful storytelling and artificial, you know, liturgy, etc., mechanical rituals. So they are losing all interest in Hinduism. In fact, it appears the most irrational, illogical religion out of all the world religions. So they seem to be on the back foot, on the defensive all the time, understandably. I am promising you this. If this particular vision that I'm presenting through the, you know, through the grace of my mentor, Swami Vivekananda, is a very rational, structured, contemporary, modern vision of Hinduism, not going back to the ancient scriptures, all that, modern vision of Hinduism, if you are able to help us, forget about me, what I'm doing at ground root level, I'm asking you, what are you doing? If you can just make sure that the WhatsApp clips you are sending out on a daily basis is, you know, kind of distributed, kind of shared with hundreds of people that you know, and ask them to share it further with another 100 people they know. If you can do this in no time, because of this magic tool we have now discovered called WhatsApp, you can present very simple, structured vision of Hinduism to your youngsters. And I promise you one thing, it's a real promise. If your youngsters start getting attached to these WhatsApp clips and start understanding the deeper vision of their tradition, forget about somebody trying to convert them. Nobody will go near them because they feel they'll get converted into Hinduism. It's such a dynamic tradition. So I'm telling you, I'm doing my bit. What are you doing, my friends? What are you doing? Unless you present this kind of, I'm just pushing this into the social media. If you don't distribute it further, then it kind of stays with you. So, I'm so clever, I learned it from Mr. Lakhani. No good. You have to spread it. So make sure these WhatsApp clips are kind of shared as widely as possible, and ask those people who are getting it to share it further. So it reaches everybody in India and worldwide. I promise you, I know, because I've got the reaction from the viewers, etc., that this is a very warm, very rational, very understandable, sensible vision of Hinduism, which really makes them feel very strong about the tradition. What made them feel weak about the tradition will make them very strong about the tradition. And from our experience, we know nobody's going to come and try and convert your youngsters, promise. In fact, they'll run away from your youngsters thinking that they will, in fact, show other tradition in a poor light. This is my answer.
Wonderful, Jaybhai.
I get worried because then they're asking me, what are you doing? I'm saying, what are you doing, friends? This is our problem. You don't, you know, do anything. And they say, oh, the other people blame this and that. We blame yourself for not really participating in the process we are kind of presenting to you.
So this is what we call armchair activism. So you can sit back, relax, and then from your WhatsApp help us spread the word.
That's the idea.
What I am doing, folks, is I am listening out for what you guys are putting on Facebook and responding to your comments and everything. So please do let us know. Any questions that you've got, leave it down in the comments and I will do my best to get it answered live today. Onwards and upwards to the next question. The next question is, what is the Hindu take on the origin of the male and the female? Richard Dawkins types of people would say that male and female begin purely as a materialistic process, in that it's the history of life on earth. Certain cells become DNA donors, others are DNA receivers, and that's all there is to it. The cultural Marxists say that male and female are arbitrary, socially constructed categories. What is your take on this?
I agree with both of these. You see, we have to be very practical and pragmatic. Look at how life kind of has been evolving for over 3.5 billion years ago on Earth. This is very clear research. You can't argue with it. You can't debate about it. It started as a single cell being, then started to split up and produce, if you like, duplicate itself. Initially, this was purely by duplicating itself that life continued to prosper. But then that process is very slow. And so in no time, this life that is trying to progress further, evolve further, discovered a new tool. If they can divide, subdivide as male and female, then if you like, this kind of male-female activity will produce a much higher form of genetic mutation, which allows life to evolve much faster than just simply splitting up. So this is, in fact, that is why they say that if you got genes from a variety of different backgrounds, the offspring will be stronger. This is modern research. So this is why what I agree with Richard Dawkins, that it is, if you like, a way life found of kind of progressing or evolving faster using this male-female division. And that is why you can have much bigger kind of mass of genetic material to play with and produce a much more evolved life. That is correct as well. And also I agree with Marx that it's a social construct. In a way, the thing that is moving from one life to another life that we call, you know, the individual soul, etc., it does not have a gender. It is, if you like, a mold that they kind of take on through the physical being that they possess, physical form they possess, as well as the mental form they possess. Because if you've been born as a male on over many lifetimes, then your mindset is already male. So if it carries forward as a male format in your in the way your mental mode tells you who you are. So you got the physical frame, you got the mental frame, and this carries on. So I agree with even this idea of that a social kind of doctrine regarding how to kind of determine who is a male and who is a female and what are their roles in society is a social construct. We understand all that. That is fine. But there's a deeper vision that comes again from this our lovely tradition, very deep rooted. It says really, if you go right to the heart of spirituality, there is this issue that there is something underpinning this reality called Brahman. But this Brahman is, at best, can be said of the nature of existence. Now, what can you do with just existence? Monotonous, homogeneous. There's nothing. You can't. Nothing can exist. So something has to rattle this Brahman in order for life, for this universe to come into being. Now, how can somebody rattle existence? It seems like impossible. This is exactly what has happened. And this is how we get this idea that the underpinning to this reality is Brahman, but then something in a way, or existence itself, and that something in a way rattles existence, so there is a shudder in existence. Now this rattling power is something that is intertwined with Brahman, and yet it is not Brahman. So in a way, this is, if you like, the first division we see, the spiritual level between Brahma, Shiva and Shakti. Shiva means the thing that is unmoving, and Shakti means the one that makes it shudder. It is this, if you like, this intertwining of Shiva and Shakti that produces the creation we experience in front of our eyes. This is a deeper spiritual dimension regarding the idea of Shiva and Shakti, or idea of male and female. And again, as human beings, we are all basically the spark of the divine. And yet, this division at the deeper level, that which is unmovable existence, is then how can it anything shudder, make existence shudder? And that we call it Shakti. And this is the beautiful way Swami Vivekananda said. He said, in reality, if you look at the creation, he says, Akash means existence itself, all-penetrating existence is the word Vivekananda uses. Not Akash means space, all-penetrating existence. And Pran, says Vivekananda. Pran means basically something that allows this, kind of thumbs existence and makes it shudder, and creation comes into being. Now you may think this is outdated. Come on, this is the most beautiful material that comes out of Hinduism that sits very well with modern quantum physics. It says existence, and shattering existence is what we experience in the material world. This is very much in line with modern physics. So if you like this idea of Shiva Shakti, or the idea of something that's unmovable, and yet somehow, we don't know exactly how, it allows it to make it shudder, and then when that shudder turns into this creation that we experience. So it's a very philosophic issue, worth exploring, because this is, if you like, the depth of Hindu tea tradition. In the Far East, we see in the Zen tradition, so you see that of yin yang, etc. But in Hinduism, it's a Shiva Shakti. So the idea of male and female, not just as human beings, a human male, a human female, but underpinning to creation is the idea of Shiva Shakti. In fact, the one of the best images of Shiva is Ardhanarishwar, deliberately giving full dignity to the idea of female as a principle.
Fabulous. It's quite a...
Sorry, well, it's very...
a deep topic.
Esoteric, but yes. It's wonderful to explore.
Amazing. So, the next question is from Sanatan Dharma. In our karmic cycle, each one of our birth is a payment or a repercussion of our previous birth, or it is determined by the karma of a previous birth. So what was the first birth? Well, since we never had a birth prior to the first birth to cause the first birth, it's almost like a tongue twister.
No, it's a good one, but the thing is this is the, you see this.
What came before the first birth?
Okay, you see the idea is this. Okay, we say that in a way our activity in a way decides how we are reborn, where we are reborn, and we reap the benefits of our action because it became part of our character and shows up in the new life, and we continue our journey because the character we molded comes with us in the next life and we allows us to progress from where we left off. It's a wonderful, deep idea. Now, the question is, how did we get started? When you think of a single cell being, do you think it's got any law of karma, what is good, what is bad, it can decide? Nothing of the sort. Basically, the force that is trying to express itself as living form, in a way, kind of winds up matter and turns into a living thing. And this living thing doesn't have the law of karma application, etc. It just kind of flows with existence. And there is no thing, a good thing or bad thing it does or karma it creates. But slowly this living form becomes much more complex, much more evolved, goes into the insect form, goes into the animal form. Again, do you think there's a law of karma applicable to the deer or the lion or nothing? They just basically are existing. And then when they come into the human kingdom, because their rational faculties have been switched on, they can now try and suss out their own condition and what they should do or not do. So until in the animal kingdom, they don't have that. In human kingdom becomes visible. So the law of karma, in a way, can only be applicable after you enter the human kingdom, because there you have got some kind of control on the way you behave, how you live your life. And this will become chiseled into your character and come with you in your next life. So how did it start? As a single cell being, what law of karma? It just kind of flows. And then it enters the human kingdom, becomes complex in human kingdom, and there it can start to make decisions.
So, Jaybhai, every week we have a session where I throw you a googly. And so today's googly is basically, If you could become immortal on the condition that you would never be able to die or kill yourself, would you choose immortality?
No. I think it's a googly question, lovely question. The answer is no. Because somehow, you know, this idea that you see in the Abrahamic tradition, you go to heaven and live forever, everything is nice, fun, that is a contradiction in term. Suppose I get, say, I'm just making a joke. Suppose I get, one laddu per day and I'm very, one chocolate cake I like. One chocolate, piece of chocolate every day. After some time, it becomes poison. You say, oh, we like that chocolate. Oh, yes, it becomes poison. Your system is such that anything you repeatedly shove down its throat, it will not tolerate. It will turn into poison. So this idea of eternal life where you can have fun is an utter nonsense. It cannot be so. So if somebody said, oh, you'll be living here for eternity, I think it'll be a prison. It'll be a horrendous place to be. So I would say, I don't want eternal life here. I'd rather in a way recognize my true dignity, which is beyond space, time, and causation. So I don't kind of be buffeted by time, say, okay, well, 1 million years gone, 2 million years gone, next kalpa starting. I'm not bothered with that. I'd rather rise above the idea that space, time, and causation in a way are kind of shackles that I want to break free from. So I'd rather not live an eternal life. That is contradiction. There is no fun that way. It's like a prison then.
Fabulous. Brilliant. So, folks, every Saturday, 1 o'clock UK time, we are in conversation with yourself, myself, and Jay Lakhani. We're trying to answer the questions on Hinduism that you may have. And the next question is, does reincarnation depend on desire at the time of death, or is it based on karma? How does the soul choose the new body? Is the selection done by Brahman?
Okay, no, Brahman doesn't play ball. He's very, very naughty chap. He doesn't play ball. The thing is this, this is very true and interesting. We say that at the time of death, the kind of thoughts you possess will in a way become a project, it will project you in that particular form in your next life. It is true, I believe that. Because in a way, when you are passing away, depending on your state of mind, of course you'll be projected or your trajectory will be decided by the way you are thinking at the time of death, understandable. But let me also say this, that is not just a temporary blip. Suppose you've been a goody-goody all your life and just at the time of death you become a bit, because you've got mental problems, you become a bit nasty. It doesn't mean your next future life is destroyed. That is just, if you like, the projector. This is how you're being, showed. But the real structure you have, the real character you have that you build up throughout your life will then kick in. So wherever you are being projected, your true character, your nature will show up as your character flourishing and becoming visible in the next life. So please do not worry too much. Provided you lead a very, very, very kind of very focused and controlled life, that particular feature that you kind of develop for yourself has become part of your character, that will hold your hand in the next life. Doesn't matter where you're projected, where you kind of find yourself. You will kind of rise above any situation you find yourself in.
Thank you everybody for joining us on the conversation today. If you like what you're listening to, please hit the like button. Let us know so we can see the little buttons pop up and I can see everybody's active. Share this video with friends and family. And we move on to the next question for today, which is basically, is there any chance for reducing our previous janma karma, so the bad karma that you've had? What are the ways? Because we realize now in this janma and decide by doing, for example, things like dan, spending on education for poor children, doing the right sort of karma and doing puja, etc. in the temples. So what percent of the bad karma will be reduced?
I'm not going to do your balance sheet for you, but let me tell you this. You see, this idea of pap and punya, in fact, that doesn't sit well with Hindus. Even though we use these words loosely, we don't believe in sin. The only sin, says Swami Vivekananda, is the sin to think that you are, if you like, anything less than the spirit. To call yourself a sinner is the biggest sin, says Vivekananda. So don't get caught up with the idea of pap punya. It is in a way to goad us in our daily life. Suppose I did something positive, I say, oh, I've done something punya, I've done something positive. And if I've done something, I've hurt somebody unnecessarily or something, I say, oh, I've done pap, I've done something negative. How do you define this pap and punya? I'll give you a very simple definition. Any activity you do that takes you back to your true nature as a spirit is considered to be punya, means positive, good. Any activity you do that takes you away from your true nature, we call papa, means it is in a way negative. How do I define it? Look, I'll give you a simple example. Suppose you help somebody who's fallen down. Why do you say it's punya? You see, because the thing that is flowing here is also flowing the same individual. So when you help, you are in a way showing your link with other human being as a spirit. By helping, by doing charitable work, by doing seva, you are in a way reflecting your link with other human beings. That is your spiritual dimension. So that process is taking you back to your nature. So it's punya. And suppose you hurt somebody unnecessarily, beat up somebody unnecessarily, kill somebody unnecessarily, then the issue is this. In a way, look, you are hurting yourself. The same thing is here is also there. So in a way, you're going against your nature. So that we call papa. It's going away against your nature, against your true being as the spirit. So anything that takes you towards your spirit, towards the idea that you are the spirit and not this body, mind, etc., all this individual with ego and all that, that is considered to be punya, means positive. Now, can you reduce it? Every instant of time, we have got this opportunity of trying to act in a way that in a way reflects our spiritual dimension. So every moment of your life, you've got this opportunity of reflecting that you are the spirit and not this external thing that you kind of are stuck with. So every act, so the way, so suppose you've done hundreds of very bad things in your past life. The moment in this life you focus on the idea that I am the spirit and I see myself reflect other human beings, other living things, the moment you do that, all your pap is burnt away instantaneously. This is the breath of vision. That knowledge, you see, it's like, suppose the room has been dark. This is a lovely example we use in Vedanta. Suppose the room has been dark for thousands of years. Does it mean that you require for light to be there for thousands of years to light up the room? No, just one boom, flicker, and the room lights up. So in the same way, the moment you begin to kind of focus on your spiritual dimension, all your kind of darkness, the work that you did in ignorance is washed away instantaneously. So your path can be washed away instantaneously the moment you kind of link up with your true identity as the spirit or as Atman. So again, this is not airy-fairy. I'm telling you, just try it. The moment you feel and thrilled by this experience, all the unnecessary stuff you may have done over millions of lifetimes gets wiped out instantaneously.
Brilliant. So welcome to Kumaril from Mumbai, Vivek. We've got Ashok Mohan from Kerala. We've got Varsha Mistry. We've got Joe Ang from Phuket. We've got Jonathan from Arkansas in USA. And Jonathan says, I've been really looking forward to this all week. I love reflecting on what you say. Thank you, Jonathan.
Thank you.
We have a question from Varsha Mistry. And she asked, how does Hinduism empower ladies?
Varshaben, you are my sister. Why are you asking difficult questions? I call Varshaben my sister. In fact, I don't have a real sister, so she decided to adopt me because he's a poor boy, has no sister, so she said, I'll adopt him. So this is how we are linked with Varshaben. Now, Varshaben, look, women have always been, if you like, the fountainhead of spirituality in every tradition, including Hinduism. It is women who hang on to traditions, their religious aspirations, that allows a religion to continue. Think about it. It's the mothers and the grandmothers tinkling bell and waving little incense stick in front of the images that bring the children back into religion. The fathers are watching TV or, you know, watching cricket matches. It is the women who are holding together not only Hinduism, every religion. They are the kind of the backbone to every tradition. And women have been, you know, given the highest dignity. Our prophets like Gargi and Maitreya and Vak were women prophets who wrote up a lot of Rig Veda. Our idea of concept of God in Hinduism, the first concept was God is female. And that is why we have always empowered. But the thing is, look, we are very good theoreticians, very poor practitioners. In reality, we have kind of waked, compromised and pushed women into the back seat. Isn't it true? Look, I keep criticizing this. When you treat your women, for example, you know, they're like, say, for example, there's a widow. They say, oh, they're inauspicious. They can't participate in a religious ceremony. Oh, dear. Then why don't we do the same to the widow, or saying, you are useless, your wife, you know, died. Oh, dear, you're inauspicious. So this shows this kind of very partisan approach we have regarding female. Not only that, even, you know, some women ask me questions, Mr. Lakhani, they say that when we have period, we can't recite the Gayatri. So why the heck not? In fact, this is the best time for recite the Gayatri. You're under pain, say, think of higher things. So women, even though we are given this high dignity, women, and female as God, etc., all the goddesses, we have in reality, in our social circle, we have kind of demolished their dignity. And the worst thing is kanyadan. I've been saying that, you know, Varshaben, to say that you have to give a daughter away as if she is an object is the worst thing you can do to a girl or a woman. So I've been telling the girls, if your parents say in the wedding there will be kanyadan, tell them there must also be a kumardan at the same time to balance the books.
Brilliant. So we have a question from Ashok Mohan. Now, this is a topic we touched on before. And in that previous video, it's a topic where you had mentioned that if a newborn child suffers, it is not because of his or her past life karma. 99% is a lot of other factors. 1% is karma. So his question is, if I do good in this life and my previous karma is also good, then in the next life, the factors are bad. I will suffer. What is the point of doing the good? And it's not being said in a negative sense.
No, you are being very pragmatic. Yeah. So look, if 99% of things that can happen to me happen by outside forces, why should you bother with the 1%? The reason is this. The thing that is within you trying to express itself through this particular, you know, kind of, you know, individual, that is trying to sort itself out. The moment he says, no, I don't want to take a break, I don't care now, I let it go because everything is out of my control. 99% things are out of my control, so even this 1%, why bother? So if you take this kind of negative attitude, you say the question is not negative, but if you take that negative attitude, your spiritual progress will stop. You turn into a piece of stone, really. So it is better to just keep waving your 1%, saying, yahoo, I got some control on my future. I'm going to keep exercising my, you know, as you said,
free will.
To carry on fighting. That shows the spirit. So don't you dare snuff it out. Even this 1% in a way shows your spiritual underpinning. So if you now kind of block that out, there's nothing left, my friend. You become a material being. So please don't subscribe to that idea. Even for this 1%, just roll up and like to enjoy. You're kind of pushing my 1% and push the 99% away. That's the attitude you should say. The sign of the spirit is not like to be confined, doesn't like to be kind of shackled. So this 99% has to be pushed aside, and this 1% must come out as a winner. That's the way attitude you should adopt.